In this episode of the Futures Thinking podcast, I'm talking with Arne Hendricks, who is an artist and a speculative designer. We discuss the Harahachibu rule, the gift of intuition and speculation. Why is it better to be 1 meter 55 centimeters rather than 1 meter 96 centimeters? What is the difference in asking questions starting with what if rather than answering yes, but? Why is the artist running a project for a commercial bank? And what are the things he cannot stop but wonder about? You are listening to the Futures Thinking podcast, where we are sharing live conversations with people of business, design, arts, culture, science and nature who are shaping our futures today. I'm your host, Agata Bisping. Hello, Arne. It's great to have you. Thank you for having you here today. You are an artistic researcher. You are a speculative designer. You are many, many things. And you also are bold to state statements that make you really think about how the world in the future will look like. And one of your statements, to shrink towards abundance, is something really different from what we've been used to see and witness in our everyday life, because abundance means being more and more, having more, searching for more, chasing more. How do you do that? How do you make people think that shrinking towards abundance is something valuable, is something that they may think of while thinking about their growth and life?
Of course, it's a very interesting question. I mean, I think most people, like you said, when they think about how to reach wealth or richness or abundance or having everything they need, that they need more of some. They need to make more money. They need to work harder. They need to accumulate more. But of course, the other way, it's simple mathematics, is that if you need less, then you will also have more. So it's a very simple idea, but it's very difficult because it's very counterintuitive, like you said. But for me, it at some point started making perfect sense, because I'm a very tall person myself, and I've always felt that somehow I was growing away from the surface of the earth somehow. I was always too far away. I always wanted to get closer. I always wanted to get into the little, into the smaller. Intuitively, and so that natural state of mind where I felt through my body that I was always hovering above the crowd, right? I was always one head bigger than most people, and I wanted to get closer. And somehow that also translated into the very obvious thing that if you want to live in abundance, then you create a situation where you need less.
This is something that is really hard to grasp, because you said that it's a mathematics that says if you want less, you still get more. And it really took me a while to understand that, despite the fact that I'm also a person for whom less is enough, that I don't need more. But still, if you think of it, really, the less you want, the less you not get, you get more, but it depends on how you define this more. I mean, it's a tricky question.
In a way, but it's also about how you get the more, because accumulation takes a lot of effort. You have to work harder. You have to find ways to get ahead. It takes a lot of your intelligence, a lot of your emotional energy. It takes a lot of everything. But needing less, somehow the growth comes as in the slipstream of needing less. This growth starts to occur naturally. So, but I agree with you that it's kind of paradoxical, because if you need less and you have more, so what is then the outcome of it? There is a mistake in the thinking, maybe, that I cannot. I mean, this is unsolvable. It's the paradox of life, you know. How can you have the intention to live in abundance and at the same time want less? Because if you want less to live in abundance, then what is the purpose of your wanting less? Is it because you want less, or is it because you want to live in abundance? This is, of course, a paradox. that is, in a way, unsolvable, I would say. But
there is one rule that you give as an example of thinking of wanting less, or of thinking of starting to want less. This is Harahachi Bu, and this is the rule that says that you can only eat until you feel not hungry. Not until you are not until you are full, but until you don't feel hunger anymore, which means that you eat up to 80% of your hunger. And this is the rule that really corresponds with the rule 80-20 for me. But do you find this relation anyhow, that, you know, there are 80% of the 20 people do the 80% of work, which is kind of reversed? Do you see any parallel in here? Or not exactly?
It's interesting. I mean, you of course, what happens is, if you start to name any number, 1/3, 1/4, 80-20, 1/5, you're going to find a sort of a resonance in society. But I think it always is useful to start investigating these resonances. Why is it? So if you're talking about that specific 80-20 rule, I haven't thought about it myself, but maybe there is something in it. It's like this 20% somehow has the space, or let's say that the 80%, how do you do that? 80% does 20% of the work, and the 20% does 80% of the work, right?
Yeah.
So there seems to be less space or more space for work, or more time or less time involved in relation. And so when I'm talking about 80-20 in terms of eating, let me first, you know, it's quite an interesting story how I came to this Harahachi Bu.
Yes, sure.
So I was in Japan, because I went to Japan because obviously this is a culture where there is a lot of interest in smallness. You have the sushi, you have bonsai, you have netsuke, these little figurines, capsule hotels. There is an understanding, a culturally embedded understanding and curiosity into less, into smallness, into a kind of minimalism, one might say. Anyway, so I wanted to visit, and I visited the island of Okinawa, because I had heard that people on this island are very small. So the elderly generation in Okinawa is on average only 150 centimeters tall, and even less, between 140 and 150. So I had to go there, and I came.
You were like a Gulliver.
I was. I was like a Gulliver in Lilliputian, with the Lilliputians in some way. But I came very late at night. I came to this island, so I wasn't expecting a lot in terms of welcome or something. So I came to the place where I was supposed to stay. But I was welcomed extremely warmly by a lady called Mrs. Kuranari, very old and indeed very, very small. She was maybe 145 centimeters, so I was already quite intrigued. And she immediately presented me with a bowl of miso soup, Japanese miso soup, with some oyster mushrooms, some seaweeds, very nice soup. And when she put this soup in front of me, she said this to me. She said, Harahachi Bu. But of course, I didn't know what she meant. I didn't understand what that meant. And so I told her I didn't speak Japanese. And then she looked at me and then she put her arm out to explain. And then she took, like, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps like this. And then she took one step back and she took this imaginary step and then she presented it to me. And, you know, because I was kind of overwhelmed with this situation, I also reached out for it, because I perfectly knew that there was nothing in her hand, not really, maybe only symbolically. But so I reached out and she put that invisible fifth step in my hand. Okay, I still didn't understand, of course. So later, when I went to my room and I was looking up Harahachi Bu, then I found out what it means. So eat until you are 80% full. Don't eat until you're completely full, but eat until you're no longer hungry. And so this 20%, this last step, this empty space that you keep inside of your body, that was the present that she gave to me. So when she gave me this bowl of soup, she didn't only give me the bowl of soup, she also gave me the 20% empty space as a gift. And of course, afterwards, and now that we are discussing it, the soup was fantastic. But of course, the 20% nothing that she put in my hand was beyond fantastic. It was amazing. For me, in a way, it was life-changing. So I don't know how it resonates with 80-20 in other ways. But for me, 20%, a kind of a 20% less, not just in food, but in many things of what we do, seemed very attainable. It doesn't sound like, oh, we have to do 50, we have to do 60%, we have
yes,
to do...
Yes, exactly.
And somehow, the 20% for me became, it became so practical, to be honest.
Yeah, and I also think that it's a safe space, and it's a space of comfort, because if you restrain to like 100%, then you think, okay, this requires a lot of effort. Sometimes it may be too hard for me. But when you think, okay, I have this 20% where I can feel comfortable, or I can do whatever I want. Or for example, if I work and I will plan 80% of my time and leave the 20% for doing actually nothing, I mean, like, not even a break, but generally leave it for unexpected, then you are calmer yourself, thinking, okay, I have made this safe place for me for anything unexpected. And also what you say about this gift, if someone gives you this 20%, that really means some, I guess you are humbled by the fact that you've been given of something that precious.
You feel
and
it,
this is something really personal for me. If someone gives you 20% of their acumen, this is something really valuable.
Yeah, and in the end, of course, you give it to yourself if you decide to work 20% less. But even that somebody, for instance, I tell a lot of my friends and colleagues, they're always so busy. You know, and I tell them, Harahachibu, you always need 20% of space. I mean, even the people that are, you know, doing so many good things and trying to make this planet a better place and are so passionate about their work, they are really pushing it. They are working so hard that you can see them crumbling, you know, and you want them to stay healthy and to also practice what they preach. Because they are, you know?
Yeah. This is also difficult for me to understand, that sometimes people forget about what they preach, because they preach so hard that it's hard for them to stop and say, oh, okay, just let me think about it. Yes, this one step back, as you've described, yeah. With your arms. Was this visit in Japan the beginning of the project Incredible Shrinking Man?
No, it was 2 years after I started it. So I started in 2010. The visit to Japan was in 2012, I think, at the end of 2012. So I think for 2.5 years I'd been working on the Shrinking Man, on this research into becoming smaller. Yeah.
Yeah, and in your research, you have come across the information that every centimeter above 1.55 meters takes 2 to 6 months of your life. And obviously for you as a really high man, because you are 1.94 meters, this is a reasonable amount of time that is taken from your lifespan. And this is also some kind of an individual relation with the height and with the growth. But what difference in thinking small would be there for the society? What I mean, if we all were smaller, how would it change our lifestyle, our ways of consumption, our lifespan? It's easy, you can calculate that easily, that you will live longer. And you said that people at Okinawa, they are the greatest number of centenaries living over there.
Super centenarians even. So that's people over 110 years old. But since they have adopted an American diet, because there's a big marine base, U.S. marine base actually on that island. Since they started also to eat hot dogs and hamburgers, the lifespan and also the height increased, the lifespan has gone down. So now Okinawa is not even average in Japan when it comes to lifespan. So we're only talking about the elderly Okinawans. But this is an experiment taking place in real time. You can look at the old people and how they eat and with their Harahachibu mentality, and you look at their grandchildren, and the difference is incredible. And that's much related to food. But that was not your question, but I just wanted to clarify that, yeah.
Yeah. So coming back, yeah.
So let's just say that we would be willing to shrink only 1 centimeter. Of course, that wouldn't have a huge impact, you would say, I think, in terms of consumption and all these kind of things. Actually, it would have some impact, but not so much. But just think about the mentality change that it would take to shrink. just this idea that we have, that we always have to become bigger, that we always need more. Of course, we talked about a little bit at the beginning, that we always have to accumulate, that bigger is better in many ways. If we would be able to switch this mentality around, the 1 centimeter for me would symbolize the switching of this mentality, where we start to realize maybe bigger is not always better. Maybe a little bit smaller can be better. And so the first centimeter would be the most important centimeter, although it would only impact maybe the philosophy that we have upon life, and therefore it would, like a stone in a river, it would ripple through society in many unexpected ways, I would think, where we don't know exactly what a mentality that's not all about more and bigger and growth would start changing how we relate to our environment, to each other, politically, environmentally, all these kind of things. That's the symbolic centimeter. But if we would absolutely become smaller, let's say, because of the laws of proportion, that's very simple. If an object is 10% bigger, like bigger or taller, if I'm 10% taller, I weigh 33% more, because you go in three dimensions. 1.1 times 1.1 times 1.1 is 1.33, is 33% more. That also works the other way around. If I would become smaller, although the percentages work a little bit different, obviously, where you shrink, but you would leave, like 10% smaller, you would need about 1/3 less. And so for me, being 195, you know, if I would be 156 centimeters or something, that's 20% less. I would weigh almost half what I weigh right now. And in terms of getting on an airplane, food, the clothes on my back, all these kind of things, you would just need way less. So that's very practical. You just need less. But the needing less and the symbolic change together, where we start to actually value the fact that we need less, that's, of course, this is the big challenge. But I truly believe that if we have any future as a species, that somehow we need to start practicing the idea, and that's basically what my work is about. And at some point, we have to actually start practicing it and embrace the idea of less. And we will, because if you look at any other form of life on this planet, they will always adapt to the circumstances. We're the only species that created this cultural buffer between ourselves and the environment in terms of cities and in terms of agriculture, in terms of anything you can imagine that makes us sort of disconnected from the direct relationship with our environment. But at some point, this can, of course, not uphold, and we will have to we have to live here. You know, of course, we can have fantasies about going to Mars, but that aside, because it's not very fun there, I would think. But anyway, that aside, this is where we were created on this planet, and this is where we belong, and this is where we'll be. And the rule of that planet is that any species always adapts to the environment it is in.
But I guess we have come to a point in which we think that we will be the species that will run the world, you know, in a way that we will run the nature, because this is deeply rooted also in the myths and mythologies and religion, especially in the Western culture, in which the God, whether it is Protestant, Christian, or Catholic, has given the world to you, and he said that you rule the nature, you rule the world. So I think what is important is the first centimeter you mentioned, to change the mindset, to change the paradigm, to change the narrative, that we can think of being shorter or of wanting less. And then again, another question comes up in my mind. This is ethically challenging, because what is the other way to be shorter than to modify the genome? Otherwise, it takes evolution, which means that it takes billions of years for us to get that short. For example, for you, from 195 to 156, it would take, I don't know, 400 years to, you know,
no,
to be...
I think maybe 2 or 3 generations, to be honest.
Really?
But, yeah, because look at the other way around also. If you look at Okinawa, the elderly are 145 centimeters, their children are 185 centimeters. In only 2 generations, because of food and because of customs, they gained almost half weight. They weigh twice as much.
That sounds feasible, I mean, to get shorter. So in this sense, there is a simple conclusion that we need to change diet in order to get shorter.
Diet is a very important thing, absolutely. But then, of course, there's also the desire. If for instance, women continue to have a preference for taller men, as they do now, I think 90 to 95% of women prefer a taller partner, then, of course, that will also be an add-on effect. And so there are certain conditions that are, to some extent, perfect for growing very, very tall. And we value them very highly because we see it as some type of quality. But if we start to see smaller as a quality at some point, then those type of diets and those type of actions will become preferred by the population. And therefore, the desire to become smaller, that is, of course, the essence. How do you start practicing and how do you start embracing the desire? Because I truly believe that if people want to become smaller, actually want to become smaller, like they want to become taller now, it just feels so natural. Oh, I wish I had 5 centimeters more. We all accept this type of little conversations on the tram or in the bus, or people always talking about these things a little bit, you know, and most of the time they want to be a little bit taller. If you just think that around, where those same conversations would be about becoming a little bit smaller, then I really believe that change could be quite fast. I mean, physically. But at the same time, again, the symbolic desire for less will maybe have even more effects in different ways, how we consume, what we consume, why we consume these things.
This is something that is deeply rooted in culture, in pop culture also, in the demands that we introduce to ourselves. And now I'm kind of optimistic that it won't take that many years, but it is really difficult and challenging to make people think that, you know, having a shorter husband is really something nice, because what is required is to have higher men, or this is some cultural construct I find difficult to agree with, but I see your point in this.
Yeah, but the culture is, of course, the result of this type of thinking, and that it is about a change of culture. It is about a change of... But you know, if we are in a completely neutral state, of course there would not be a difference. That there are some animal species where the male is much smaller than the female. There are quite a few, and those females do not want big men. For instance, you have the pygmy squid. You know, always chooses the smallest men. There is the red-eyed tree frog. They have this situation where the female sits in the middle and then the men gather around, right? And they do this, it's called lekking. They start to make a lot of noise and try to impress the female frog. And the alpha males, the big, strong males, they are always very close. They are the first circle because they are strong. They will make sure that they are very close. But this is a very, very patient female. So she this first 12 hours of all these alpha males making noise, she doesn't make a move. She doesn't accept any advances. And she waits and she waits. And those alpha males are getting a bit tired now. They're getting a bit tired because they're big, they need to eat, they need to sleep, you know. And so they, at some point, they just leave, they give up. And now the beta males, the also quite tall males, but not very tall, they are in the second ring around in the lekking system. And they see their opportunity and they start to da-da-da. Female still waits, not interested. And those beta males also leave. And this is the moment when the smallest males that are in the outer circle of this thing start to try to make an impression. And only, and that can take up to 36 hours, something. Only then, and most of the time, the very smallest, does she make a choice and she chooses a small partner. This is a tree frog, so there's also all kinds of reasons for her to want to be small. But it just shows that there are other opportunities, other possibilities out there. It doesn't have to be the way we have done it. You can say, yes, but we are our species. This is how we do it. But we have culture to change ourselves. That's the nice thing about culture. We have culture to put the buffer between us and our world. Or we can have a culture that maybe looks for that connection to our environment even more forcefully than an animal species would. We have these choices. So we can play with these things. As an artist, of course, playing with these things is what I'm very interested in.
Yeah, that was also what comes to my mind, is that time, patience and resilience are the qualities that we need to develop in order to be smaller. And also that there is the money issue that would really make it hard for us to want less. or if we change the our minds to not wanting to have more money, simply not stop being greedy. And as far as the money is concerned, you've been you had an artistic residency at Rabobank, which is the bank that invests in, if I understood it correctly, in rural areas, had some investments based on the crops, on food. And what was your artistic project about during your residency at the Rabobank?
So the Rabobank is the biggest agricultural investor, the biggest investor in agro-food in the world. There is no other bank in the world that invests so much money in farms in Australia, wine farms in France, in dairy production in Brazil. They are the ones that are financing a lot of our food system. So in a way, they're also financing a lot of our problems, because we know that some of our biggest problems are related to how we have organized our food system. So that's the Rabobank. They also are very big on mortgages in the Netherlands. Everybody has a mortgage with Rabobank for their houses. So they do all kinds of things. It's a cooperative bank. It doesn't necessarily have a profit for profit mentality. So it's a corporation, but still, it's a very established and very influential bank. Rabobank came across me when I was doing a project in Utrecht, where I was working together with a cancer research institute, where I was investigating the relationship between how a tumor or how cancer grows or how cancer develops and how the economy develops. Because a lot of people will just say things like, oh, the economy is like a cancer. It's like a tumor. But then they leave it. There. It's just this kind of a metaphor that they want to say that the economy is very bad and then it stops there, right? But I thought, what if it's true? What if actually we start to analyze the economy and we find these kind of resonances with what happens in a cancer? Because cancer has all these moments, you know, there are all kinds of different aspects to cancer and how it develops, what mutates, what goes wrong in the system before it actually becomes deadly. So I was doing this research at a cancer research institute together with cancer researchers and economists in Utrecht. And I had a kind of a research facility where I was entertaining dialogues between cancer researchers and economists. So I put them around a table and I had them talk about growth together and malignant growth together. And to see if they could learn from each other, if there was some sort of space between them that they would understand each other, they actually understood each other. Both of them, both let's say disciplines, more than once said that actually this was something that they did think about quite often. The cancer researchers quite often thought about economics and how it sort of resonated with what they were researching, and the other way around as well. So that was interesting. But the interesting thing was that a group of people from the Rabobank came to see that project, because Rabobank also has an art collection. And a very interesting sort of artistic research group. And Virili Klaassen runs that. She's the head of the art department of the Rabobank, and she works very intensely together with Godelieve Spaas. They came with a group of bankers, and they came. So they didn't come into an easy situation, let's say, because that was, you know, it was about cancer and economy, etc. And they said, "This is what we want to." We would like to invite you to come in the bank and research this topic with us, research growth. Talk to us about these topics, because we as a bank know that things are changing. We know that we have to change. We need to be ready for what's coming. And so they invited me to spend more than, like, I was there for a year and a half investigating growth. From the perspective of the bank, but also from the perspective of the incredible shrinking man. I was also investigating shrinkage and growth and how shrinkage can sometimes lead to abundance, like we discussed before, or, you know, just to create a kind of a mental space to not always only think about interest or to think about growth in terms of banking growth, where you put 1 euro in and you need to get 1 euro and a little bit more out. Which means that you're always looking for growth somewhere. Otherwise, the whole system doesn't work. The whole banking system doesn't work if there's no growth, because this is the money goes in and a little bit more money needs to go out. And that's how you pay your people and your stockholders and all that kind of stuff. So for me, it was a very challenging and very interesting situation to talk about these things. And we did for a year and a half. I mean, we don't have the time to talk about all the things that happened there, but it's still ongoing. I still work with them quite a lot.
I'm just highly interested in how you talk about growth with a bank and how you convince them to think that 1 euro in does not need to equal 1.5 euro out. I mean, this is some, how do you do that? I mean, you can talk with the CEOs, you can talk with the top management, but on the other hand, there are salespeople that are being, you know, their job is to earn money for the bank. And how do you make that people think that, well, let's consider growth? What kind of tools you use, and what is the outcome of your research for the Rabobank?
Yeah, well, you know, of course, you're not going to go in there and talk to the CEOs and convince them in a few days or even in a year that they don't need to get more money out than they put in. I mean, that's not going to happen. What's going to happen is that you create a space for debate, dialogue, questioning things, creativity, creative thinking, speculation about what if thinking. So what if we would be doing this? What does it mean for a bank? So people there come in the morning, they never have space for this type of thing. They're always thinking about growth. All of a sudden, there's a space where they're invited to think about something else.
So you are introducing 20% of your time, of their time, to think about speculation.
This is what you could see. I didn't do it that literally. I don't think Hara Hachibu was so much part of my thinking at the time. It really gained more momentum in the last 2 years or so. But it was all about creating space. It was all about creating space to think about it from a different, to look at it from a different perspective. I think this is the most important thing that you can do in such an organization, is to create some space. So I become an excuse for them to think about things that they normally do not think about. They don't have the time for it. They don't have the money for it. I don't know.
So it was a space, like a space in time, but also was there a dedicated space, like a material space for you, like a studio or like a place where you could meet and discuss? And you had your exhibition, I believe, also within this project. You have come up with a newspaper. Was it distributed monthly, quarterly, or how often? And what has Rabobank has been left with after the end of your residency? What was the outcome of your residency over there?
So I'm still working with them. So let's say the outcome is still, my work never really has a very concrete outcome in that way. It's a process. I believe these things take a long time. The Incredible Shrinking Man is a project that I'm working on already since 2010. So that's already 11 years. I don't think things are going to change. I don't consider these things, oh, it's a nice story, let's just put it up, have some nice images, a little story, we open up the mind for half hour and then it's done. For me, it's really about doing the digging, constantly digging, all the time, continuing to go through whatever it's a process of making sure that this type of thinking is always somehow present.
Okay.
In the bank, for instance. And the thinking is still present in the bank because I still work with them. I wrote a series of columns for them during Corona as well, which is long after the residency. They've also invested in a few artworks. They are the only people that have ever bought artwork from me, because I never make things that you can buy, but they've bought. And these artworks are words. They are neons that are part about it. They are about, one of them is abundance. It's a kind of a neon that is about dancing and abundance. And the other one is mature nature. It is a neon that changes from mature into nature and back all the time. It's kind of hesitating between mature and nature. Also a reflection on, are we becoming mature now as a species, or are we going to become, let's say, small, or are we just following nature? It's a kind of a, so they are very much still invested in my work and in my thinking, and invite me often to take part in debates and things. And so in this way, like when an art collection buys a painting, they put it on the wall and you're there. The painting is always doing its work, basically, right? It's speaking.
You are the ripples, yeah. You are the something that is working as the ripples after the stone you have stated. But also, what comes to my mind is that you are a disruptor, be we had problems with definition of how to write your visit card today. And I think that what you are saying, with all the speculations, with all this tender enforcement to make people think differently, you cause disruption. You cause people to stop and think differently, and this is the outcome, not a point, not a standpoint in which they said, we get it, but this is the okay, let's think how it may work differently. But there's also one example that I came across with your work at Robobank, was the cabbage experiment, that you have ordered a lot of cabbage heads. And can you say something more about this creativity tool, as I can describe it?
Yeah, of course I will. First, I appreciate your comment about the disruption and about being the disruptor there. And also, it also, how do you say it, illustrates the point that it's not me knowing and you not knowing, or me knowing and the banker not knowing, and I have something that I know, and now you need to also know it. We don't know. But we don't know together. And I allow you also to not know. You don't have to be in control. Let's just figure this out. So that is already the disruption to normal events, where people always have to know. They have to be a specialist. They have to have an answer. They have to have a fact. But in terms of what we are looking at humanity at the moment, we don't know so well. You know, we don't know. So the disruption needs to happen just to be aware that no, we don't know, but we have to kind of work together and be interested in each other. The cabbage dinner, it was together with Rabobank, and we did that at Mediamatic in Amsterdam. At some point, I don't know, is that 3 years ago? Three years ago, there was a very, very big white cabbage harvest. There was so much white cabbage that it became completely worthless because of the weather conditions, the perfect rain, perfect sunshine, perfect temperature, everything was perfect. So there was so much white cabbage that it was an abundance of cabbage. There was cabbage everywhere. And of course, the paradox in the economic system is that when you have a lot of something, when it's abundantly there,
it's worthless.
Then it's worthless. And that is so strange, because basically marketing and the economy is always trying to sell us the idea of abundance. Always trying to, take my product, you will feel amazing, abundantly, blah, blah, blah. But the moment it actually arrives, this abundance, then the economy doesn't know what to do with it, because it's all about creating scarcity, and then, you know, scarce means you pay more money for it, etc., etc. So we decided, so the thing was that all these white cabbage would just be left on the field. They didn't even want to harvest it, because harvesting cost money, and the cabbage was worthless. So it would, you know, they would lose money by harvesting this incredibly beautiful cabbages that were perfect. They were brimming with life, and they were healthy, and they were amazing. Fields filled in Belgium, in Germany, in the Netherlands, everywhere, fields of white. And so we said, let's do something about at least one of these fields. Let's buy all these cabbages, and we'll just do a meal with cabbage. But we do nine course dinner, high-end dinner, with worthless cabbage. So we don't add. So, and you still pay 65 euros for this nine course meal, because we add our love, we add the expertise of the chefs, we add the expertise of cultures, because we had meals from all over the world, recipes from all over the world, from Japan, from South America, from Africa, from the Netherlands, of course, Germany. We had nine amazing courses of white cabbage, showing that if we add our culture and our love and our that this is not worthless. That if there is abundance, that we need to act rather than live according to the economic principles, which said destroy those cabbages, we keep a few, and those we can sell for a lot of money. So it just showed a different approach to how to deal with abundance. And the Rabobank paid for those cabbages. They had the connections with the farmers, so they were very facilitating in this whole process, and also. They came, many, many people from Rabobank came to have those dinners. We had like four evenings with very, very long tables, you know, just white cabbage.
I'm sometimes left speechless, because there are so many things coming to my mind, and I think that if you make people experience things, they can internalize them later on. I mean, never it would come up to a mind of a bank official or a person that works in a bank to go to that dinner with the cabbage as a main theme, being the top, you know, exclusive dine and dish. And it just leaves me with the conclusion that if you invite people to experience a balance experiment, the one that does not make them feel, I don't know, I'm afraid, and does not make them feel stupid or not too, you know, wise enough, but then you immerse that person with that experience and say, okay, just I will just leave you here and you are doing with this whatever you want, then it's just a wonderful experience for that person to start talking about it with other people and start thinking about what he has been doing with his life or what are his plans for the next few years. And even if he thinks about it for at least 2 weeks ahead, that's the outcome of your work. Basically, that there is that the ripples that it states. And also, it also relates me to the 80-20, that this experiment that you leave 20% of the safety because you leave the conventional dining with the cabbage inside. So that is something nice. And then we have another connection, the cabbage and the food. And now you are at the artistic residence at Wageningen University. And what is your research over there?
So Wageningen University and Research is the one of the two or three best universities in the field of agriculture in the world. People from all over the world come to study there. This is also, of course, you know, the Netherlands are very upfront when it comes to food technologies and all these kind of things. So Wageningen is basically the center of all this knowledge, where it's generated, etc. I was invited to think about protein transition there. So how are we going to convince people that it's better to eat less meat and more plant-based proteins? And how they said it in the beginning was very funny to me. They said, it's not a very sexy topic. As if they were bringing me in to make it sexy, which is not something that I do. I'm not a marketeer, etc. I'm an artistic researcher, though I do very autonomous work. I use the freedom of an artist to dig myself into a topic. But I immediately recognized this toughness in the protein transition as something that was very deeply related to my other work. First, it takes food as a medium to talk about other things as well. So food for me is always the most powerful medium to discuss politics, to discuss economics, to discuss cultural things going on. And for me, this whole, the difficulty that we have as a species to start changing our diet towards a less damaging way of eating, less dairy, less meat, it's a deeply cultural question. It really is about who we are and who we are becoming as a species. So I immediately recognized that there was something that was valuable to me. And then, of course, this whole eating of meat and also says something about us. It's always also related to wanting to be powerful and strong and being in control of your environment and all these kind of questions that are also part of our body and of the incredible shrinking man as well, or my research into growth. So this is what I'm doing now. I'm working with scientists. So at the bank, I was working more with managers and with bankers and with financial people. At the Wageningen University and Research, I'm mostly working with scientists that do research in the field of the protein transition. Some might do research on chickpeas or on algae or on duck cress. They're always looking for these other sources of proteins. So I'm creating, again, a kind of a space between science, in this case, between science and art, where we can, yeah, learn from each other.
So your job there is to create, again, some experiences. You are like a medium, meaning a translator, a person who in a way translates the language of scientists and researchers into a narrative that is understandable by people, that touches their hearts and that makes them feel what is empirical and what is research, if you know what I mean. I mean, to translate the transition of the proteins, which is kind of difficult.
I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying, but I'm sorry. I have to completely deny that's what I'm doing. It's funny because this is exactly what always happens in the beginning. And I've had this experience before, is when art and science works together, the artist is considered to be an illustrator of the scientific work. So the translator, the transport.
Yeah.
Whereas art is a completely other type of knowledge. We are not illustrators of what is already out there. We have a different way of approaching a topic. We have artistic tools to approach a topic, and we create, we fill a space, we fill stories, but that's of course something very different. And we might be looking at the same topic, but that's different than seeing yourself as an illustrator of, okay, you found this crazy protein inside of duck cress. Now I'm going to make a product for you.
This is not what I mean. It's not like illustrating. It's like using the research to build a new value that's being expressed through artistic means.
That happens, but at the same time, for instance, I'm working with Rick Wiegers, who's a scientist working with algae. And I came into his lab, and you can see all these incredible machines with algae going through them, green sludge, and they do a lot of, because algae is almost the panacea of our time. We want it to solve our energy crisis, we want it to solve our chemicals crisis, we want it to solve our CO2 crisis, our food crisis. It is like algae will save the world if you listen to the algae world, right? So I was, of course, immediately triggered by this field. And I came there and I saw all these incredible machines. And so my question to Rick was, after some time, was what would you like to do with these machines if you could do anything? So I basically, and then he said, well, I would like to, it would be interesting to maybe put more than only one algae in one of these machines. Because, of course, the Cartesian system in science is that you cut these very complex situation into very small pieces so that you can understand what goes on. So they take one algae, they put them in a beautiful machine. The machine is called the Algae Mist, which is kind of funny.
Wizard all of a sudden.
Yeah, yes. Exactly. So they are kind of also making fun of themselves in a way. But and you put it in there, and then you slightly change the temperature, you slightly change how much CO2 goes in the water, you slightly change salinity or something. You always make small change, but you never put two algae in one, because then you don't know exactly what is influencing what. So you don't really like complex systems as a scientist. You want simplicity. You make models. You simplify reality, basically. But his secret fantasy was actually to create a complex system and to have more than one algae. So I suggested to him to put four algae in there. And now we have already for a while, we are running in their equipment a community of four algae, which is creating all kinds of data that Rick really doesn't know what to do with, because he doesn't know where this data is coming from. It still looks the same, graphs going up and down, and you know, and it's incredible, you know. So it's not even that his scientific facts and research turn into some story or into something. We are actually doing this research together. I created just the excuse for him to follow his passion or to follow his curiosity.
So that's again, you are a disruptor.
Yes, so that's also why I appreciate so much that comment that you made before, because I think it's much more this, or maybe an excuse even, right?
Yeah.
The excuse for Rick to be able to do something with those $1,000 machines that normal science normally doesn't allow. So art creates the space for science to do fundamental other research, because as we all know, science is more and more forced into a very specific direction where it needs to create results, and
yes,
those results are then turned into startups or businesses or even paid by businesses. So science that was very wide and open and about fundamental curiosity of our species is turning more and more and more and more into research and development for the corporate world. And so art is kind of trying to pry open, I try to pry this open and to create space again for fundamental curiosity, because I think that's also what we need, fundamental creativity.
Yeah. I just can't help but wonder whether your meeting with this professor was just 20% for him in his 80% work that is being, you know, driven by research and data and money, and this 20% leaves this basic curiosity for him to say, well, I'm the wizard right now, yes, because this
exactly.
is